Welcome to the final part of our A-Z of the rip-offs on the Amiga. And most of these are PD rip-offs, because I like to think that the commercial ones are homage to the better games out there, where they have taken the inspiration. And this is one of my favourite ones. This is Cyberzerk, and as you can see, it takes inspiration from Berserk, because you can see the walls, and also it takes some inspiration from Alien Breed as well. In certain spots, you'll have to anticipate the enemies and shooting down here before the enemies have had time to attack. Making a hole is one way to get through that barrage. The screen is a puzzle unto itself, and you can usually time and evade enemies, so all you have to do is wade in there. And we do have a long time limit, 19 minutes to complete every single level. Given a few hand grenades and some power-ups as well, and sometimes we can take on these enemies from different routes, and sometimes we can even lob grenades over walls and destroy enemies the easy way. The aim of the game is to clear every single one of the rooms on this spaceship, a lot like Paradroid, and if you spend too long in a level, then some things will attack like Berserk and you'll be forced out of that room and you'll have to enter it all over again. This is sometimes tight on some rooms, so after I've destroyed enemies, I feel it's best to leg it, and then simply entering the same room again means the way is clear. Part of the fun of this game is also the tremendous music. Moving back to T-Racer, this has been reviewed recently in the Lemon Amiga reviews, so I really don't need to go into this one. It's obviously borrowing heavily from Project X. Very fancy backgrounds on level 1, but they are not cloned on all the later levels, unfortunately, and so level 1 is the best level graphically in the entire game. If you want to see more of that, you can certainly see the review. For more of a film license, we can check out this one. This is RoboCop 4. The introduction to this game, and this probably contains the best module of the RoboCop theme ever.
Your move, Rick. Drop it!
Moving on into the game itself, well, they've taken the 3D perspective and they've made that isometric 3D, and what we get instead is RoboCop walking around an isometric 3D landscape. The aim of the game is to collect a number of keys on this very first level to break out of this warehouse, and you'll have to find three different keys in three different colours, and having done so, you'll be able to get the key to the exit. Drop it. Each of the keys opens a door, and that door has got some kind of a code wheel on there, and what we have to do is to type in the code that we found on the key. So that's 7425. Game, we pull left and right to turn left and right and forward to move forwards. I'm not quite sure what the backwards does, but that means it's sometimes a handful controlling RoboCop. But on this first level, we can pick up a number of extra lives and at least one or two time resets as well. And also we can press the spacebar and access a map of the whole level. And sometimes we find ourselves in dead ends, so this level will have to be memorized, so you can have to march from thing to thing and restock our energy before it runs out. Move on to Pinball Hazard, which is dangerously close to being commercial. I probably think that this was released, and this is definitely a homage to a certain series. You can see this one reminds us of certain racetrack themes on certain other pinball games, and even the sound effects also remind us of those same games. Seems to be borrowing from Pinball Fantasies, and most of this game would be identical if it wasn't for the graphics. Moving on to the Nightmare Table, the Vampire Table, we get to see some more nightmarish antics in this game, and you can see most of the ramps have been taken away, so it's quite an easy level with lots of things that you have to bump, just like the ignition table. You may notice the makers of this game, Mirage, well, that would be a hallucination of Pinball Fantasies perhaps. And Magic Image is another name for Mirage, which is another name for something which doesn't really exist. But this game does exist, unfortunately, on the Amiga. Unfortunately, the ball is just too heavy to have fun with this game, and it really does lead to quite a deflating experience, and if only the ball was a little bit lighter, it could have even saved this rip-off experience. Yet another rip-off is a more F1 licenseware title, and that was F1 Racer, that was created by Lee Briggs. You can see it represents one circuit, that's Silverstone, and we can also change all the various parameters, including the brick balance and everything else from another game that you might remember on the Amiga called Jeff Crammond's Formula One Grand Prix. Just like that game, we can also change camera angles and inside far front view and rear view, as well as trackside monitors are on offer. After a qualifying, we'll get the starting grid, and then it's on to that race itself. We can also change the fuel as well. This being an F1 licenseware title, unfortunately it's not the most perfect and complete game in the list, but this was released as licenseware, at least on the Amiga, and this game was not only a rip-off of Formula One Grand Prix, but it also went on to inspire another certain Atari Jaguar game, and I wonder if you can recognise what that is. But at the moment, the most difficult part is the AI is pretty strong, and they will leave us for dead if we try to be too brave in this game. You might notice a little bit of flickering going on, but apart from that, there is smoothness on offer, and it's quite a smooth game because I'm playing this on an NTSC machine, all 30, and that means that the game plays in full screen and as quick as it's probably going to get. This may be an accurate representation of 1991 Silverstone, but unfortunately it's not as playable as Formula One Grand Prix. You can see some flickering going on as well. It certainly had the potential, and as a one-man band offer, this was a great title on the Amiga. Although not many people have heard about this, it's definitely got the racing heritage. Look at that, we can even run off the road and get back on it again. So this is one of the better rip-offs on the Amiga. Thought that nobody could even attempt to rip off Lotus, well, here is the proof of that. Here is Lotus Esprit Turbo Challenge 96K, and this thing takes a million years to decompress, but once it has done, you can select from easy, medium and hard modes, and you can select from all of the races on all of the tracks in Lotus Esprit Turbo Challenge. And you can see some liberties have been taken with the game modes, and this game does actually work in two-player mode as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch to two-player mode just to show you what that looks like. And we can check out the first stage. This is Portugal, and this may seem very familiar. Yes, this is Lotus Esprit Turbo Challenge by Gremlin Graphics, only it's been compressed down to 96K, and after decompression you can see the graphics are a little bit more chunky than they were before, and you don't get any music, all you get is the sound effects. And surprisingly up close these graphics do look good, but at any distance apart from basically right in your face, they do look very blocky indeed. The speed is there and the two-player action, and if it wasn't for the huge decompression time, I definitely recommend players, the series, fans of the show, to check this out. It's even as a pit, so let's check out the pits, and we can see some graphics have been overlaid on top, and I wonder why they didn't release a construction kit. That would have been a great game, but then again, who needs that when you've only got 96k? I guess My favourite part is the title music, and that really does sound terrific. And if only they'd incorporated that into the Commodore 64 version. Lastly, we get to the most commercial game on our list. This is Football Glory, which was commercial at one point and then withdrawn from sale after a certain Sensible Software's John Hare sued them, and they rushed this off the shelves and back into the high prices on eBay. You can see this game pays more than a homage to a certain Sensible Software's Sensible Soccer, and you can see that this game really does take the Michael. Like all of the rip-offs that we've seen so far, sometimes they actually improve upon the original, and on this one they have improved on the original by adding lots of graphics, which are the slide marks of the player sliding around the pitch, and I guess on a very muddy pitch that would be very great at the end of a long match. And they have also improved a number of other things as well, but you can see most of the format, most of the formula, seems to borrow heavily from the aforementioned game. One of the great touches in this game is you'll get speech bubbles emerging from the referee, who seems to be bald in this case, and it's funny watching the referee bobbing around, and you can see different tactics can be involved, and you can do scissor kicks and things like that, and the end of match or end of goal celebrations can be funny to watch as well. Apart from that, this is Sensible World of Rip-Off, and you can see that even the action replays are in the game. Pity that they didn't have a spinning R, which spins around in a corner, or that should be a spinning S. So in response to that, that game was ripped off the shelves, literally, and in its place, this is Five-A-Side Soccer. It's made by the same Croatian team, and all they did was they made it five-a-side and they changed the backgrounds. It's more or less the same game, and it's got the same graphics and the same animations as well. And again, it's funny to see those animations being added to what is essentially SWOS. So, thank you for watching this collection of games.